Very good afternoon to all of you, and welcome all to the clinical combined round. The first case, Department of Hematology will present a case. It is actually a hematological emergency normally we encounter, but now few years because diagnosis is very early nowadays, you don't see normally. So we'll now start with, I think we'll request Dr. Mona to start the case.
So I present today a case of a 17-year-old male who is a resident of Delhi, who was admitted with us on 15th of February 2021 and is currently admitted with us. He presented with chief complaints of progressive swelling in the left side of neck and upper chest from 2 years, loss of weight for 4 months, intermittent fever 2 months, facial swelling 4 days and stridor 2 days. History of presenting illness. The swelling in the neck was painless. Starting on the left side of the neck, it was pea-sized to begin with. Progressively increased in size to the current size, which is approximately the size of a football, over the past 2 years. The swelling progressed to the back of the neck from the past 2 months, below the neck and to the right side from the past 15 days. He also had unintentional loss of weight of 10 kgs over 4 months. Fever of 2 months duration, which was high grade, intermittent, not associated with chills, stridors of fever or rashes. Afebrile for 5 days prior to admission. He presented to the AIIMS emergency with facial swelling from 4 days and stridor from 2 days. History of presenting illness. He had no complaints of drenching, night sweats, weakness or bony pains. No complaints of dysphagia, hoarseness of voice, seizures or neurological deficit. No complaints of any other swellings on any other part of the body. No testicular swelling. No complaints of cough, hemoptysis or a contact with a TB patient. No history of recurrent infection from childhood. Journey before AIIMS. In this, I would be explaining about the investigations and treatment history coming before he came to AIIMS. In February 2019, he had a swelling in the neck, left side of the neck, which was pea-sized. FNAC done from a government hospital outside showed very atypical cells. In April and May, he was advised to get a cervical lymph node biopsy, which showed no evidence of lymphoma, lymphomatous proliferation. Mycobacterium tuberculosis was also not detected. But he was started on empirical ATT, which he took for 8 months. In November 2019, he had no response to ATT. FNAC was repeated from a government hospital, very atypical cells. Again, referred for a lymph node biopsy outside. Axillary lymph node was biopsied this time, which showed angiofollicular hyperplasia, but no evidence of lymphoma still. From March, just before COVID, from an oncology center, he was started on prednisolone, weekly methotrexate and monthly vincristin. No documented reduction in size. The patient stopped treatment from September by himself. And on 15th of February 2021, he visited the AIIMS emergency with stridor. General physical examination baseline. From 15th of February, he had pallor, facial puffiness, bilateral conjunctival congestion, anasarca, distended neck veins and upper limb veins. There was no icterus sinusus or clubbing. His vitals, he was afebrile, pulse rate was 110 per minute, respiratory rate was 22 per minute, he had intermittent episodes of stridor, oxygen saturation was 100%, requiring 2 liters per minute of oxygen. Blood pressure was 152 by 90, sitting right arm supine. Examination of neck mass on baseline, he had an extensive neck mass involving the left supra and infraclavicular region, which was 12 into 15 centimeters approximately. It was immobile, firm, 2 ulcers at previous biopsy sites measuring 2 into 2 centimeters, hyperpigmented skin changes, skin was non-pinchable, it was non-tender, it was not moving with deglutition. Bilateral axillary and inguinal lymph nodes 2 into 2 centimeters were also noticed. In systemic examination, it was within normal limits. So in summary, we have a 17-year-old male, symptomatic from 2 years with a huge neck mass on left side of neck with B symptoms, with multiple inconclusive FNAC and biopsies, no response to ATT, steroids, methotrexate, vincristin, presented to us without a diagnosis with generalized lymphadenopathy, stridor and grade 4 SVC syndrome. It was very difficult to have a differential diagnosis in this patient. The most common presentation in this age group is lymphoma, so that was the most first our first differential diagnosis. Rest were kept as germ cell tumor, multicentric Castleman disease, and multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Now I call Dr. Prerna to present the laboratory and bone marrow biopsy findings.
On the lab investigation, we had hemogram of 7.9 with TLC of 69,000, and the smear shows neutrophilic leukocytosis. So there was a predominantly neutrophilic predominance with reactive thrombocytosis of platelets around 7.35 lakh. The anemia was predominantly normo-normo with presence of microcytic hypochromic RBCs and anisocytosis. The other hematological investigation and biochemical parameters, no TLS parameters were found, and the albumin was mildly reduced to 3.4 gram per deciliter. The coagulation profile was normal. On the bone marrow aspirate finding, it was a cellular smear with showing predominance of the granulocytic hyperplasia. So we can see predominantly there are the granulocytes which are increased with presence of few normoblastic erythroid precursors. So there was a relative reduction of the erythroid precursors. And there were few plasma cells which constituted around 8%. So reactive plasma cells and few histiocytes were there. The megakaryocytes were adequate with platelet counts also seen. On the bone marrow biopsy, it was a fairly cellular bone marrow biopsy with preserved megakaryocytes. And again, there was granulocytic hyperplasia. However, there was no lymphoid aggregate. There were no atypical RS cells or atypical mononuclear cells. There were no features of necrosis, fibrosis, granuloma, or metastatic deposit. So it was a cellular reactive bone marrow biopsy with no evidence of any lymphoma deposit. Now I would like to invite Dr. Emily for her lymph node biopsy findings.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I'd like to discuss the histopathological findings of the lymph node biopsy. We've got a Truecut biopsy of the neck, which comprised of multiple bits of soft tissue, which showed abundant areas of necrosis and few areas of viable cells. The viable areas comprised predominantly of a polymorphous population of cells. So we can see it is comprising of eosinophils, histiocytes, small lymphocytes, and few large atypical monolobated cells, including few mummified cells. Then we further proceeded to do immunohistochemistry. On immunohistochemistry, these large atypical cells were immunonegative for CD3, CD20. CD30 showed Golgi zone accentuation and was positive in all the cells. CD15 showed a lot of background. So we can see that there are some large cells which showed a little bit of CD15 positivity, but due to the background, we call it a non-contributory stain. Alpha was negative in the large cells. CD43 was negative in the larger cells. SALPRO was also negative. And then there, since there was abundant necrosis, we proceeded to do some fungal stains and gel lesion stain to see for any acephalous bacilli. So special stains did not reveal any acephalous bacilli or any fungal profiles. So finally, we gave a diagnosis of a classical Hodgkin lymphoma, possibly nodular sclerosis type. I would like to now call Dr. Shivani from the Department of Radiology to discuss the CCT findings. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I shall be describing the CCT findings of this patient. So this patient had undergone a CCT from AIIMS on 14th of Feb 2021, that is this year itself, where we can see that there is this heterogeneous soft tissue attenuation mass in the bilateral posterior cervical region, which is seen to go into the extending within the cervical canal in the epidural space, and it is encasing the left vertebral artery as well. In the next caudal sections, we can see that this mass is extending into the till the level 4 of the neck. And on the contralateral side also, we can see that there are multiple enlarged discrete lymph nodes. So this soft tissue mass likely represents a conglomerated lymph nodal mass. In the subsequent caudal sections, we can see that there is involvement of the left clavicle, which is clearly seen on the bone window as irregular lysis of the medial aspect of the clavicle with cortical thinning and interrupted periosteal reaction. This mass is extending into the left supraclavicular region with involvement of the anterior chest wall as well. And we can see that there is involvement of the esophagus, which can be appreciated as irregular thickening of the esophageal wall, and there is narrowing of the airway lumen as well. In this craniocaudal, in this coronal section, we can appreciate the craniocaudal extent of the mass very well. Here we can see that there is obliteration of the left ICA and left IJB in left brachiocephalic vein, whereas the right brachiocephalic vein, left right IJB are clearly seen. The SVC is also clearly seen. In the subsequent cauterization, we can see that there are a number of collaterals seen in the anterior chest wall. The mass is infiltrated into the anterior chest wall, and there are multiple enlarged axillary lymph nodes. And in the visualized upper abdomen, you can see that there are multiple lymph nodes in the peripancreatic and periportal location. So based upon this, since that there are multifocal lymph nodal masses, usually was lymphoma, and in view of that there was clavicle involvement, clavicle lytic lesion with periosteal reaction, we also kept a DDO, Ewing sarcoma family of tumors. So we were also provided with a CT done outside, dated 10 September 2019. Here we can see that the mass was smaller in size, and in this section, you can see that the mass was fungating in appearance and it was encasing the right left IJB. No contralateral lymph nodes were appreciable in any on the right side. And in the coronal section, we can see that it was obliterating the left IJB and ICA. Now, just to show that how the mass has progressed in size from September 2019 to February 2021, we can see that the mass has increased in size and there is a superficial ulceration with involvement of the skin. Also, we can clearly appreciate the involvement of the clavicle in the recent scan, which was not there earlier, and the involvement of this large chest wall mass. Yeah, now, I would like to invite Dr. Jasim to describe the PET CT.
With this history, the patient was sent to us for staging PET CT. And this is the maximum intensity projection of the patient, showing increased FDG uptake in the cervical, bilateral axillary, thoracic and abdominal region. And this is the axial section showing increased FDG uptake in the bilateral cervical lymph nodes. And there is an increased FDG uptake in the heterogeneous density mass in the posterior cervical region. And also there is an exophytic mass in the left cervical region. With areas of ulceration, and the mass is extending inferiorly up to the anterior chest wall, and also there is involvement of the left pectoral muscles, and we can see that there is bilateral axillary lymph node involvement, and also there is mediastinal lymph nodes or FDG a bit. And in the next section, we can see that there is enlarged peripancreatic, periportal lymph nodes and para-aortic lymph nodes, which are FDG avid, and there is also increased uptake in the bone marrow. And from this, the final conclusion will be there is FDG metabolically active lymph nodes in the both sides of diaphragm, with areas minimal bilateral pleural effusion and ascites and muscular deposits. So our likely diagnosis will be lymphoma.
So with the stage 4 Hodgkin's lymphoma diagnosis, we put the Hessen-Cleaver International Prognostic Score, which came out to be 6 in a patient, giving stating that the progression-free survival at 5 years, 42%. The diagnosis and staging is classic Hodgkin lymphoma with grade 4 superior vena cava syndrome, stage 4B, and prognostic score of Hessen-Cleaver Index 6. The hospital course, he presented to us on 15th of February with Strider and grade 4 SVC syndrome. Dexamethasone 10 mg OD was started for Strider for decreasing the laryngeal edema, and it was continued up to 20th of February. True cut biopsy was done within 48 hours. Strider had improved and Dexa was withheld pending biopsy reports. On 23rd of February 2021, we got a diagnosis of classic Hodgkin lymphoma. ABVD cycle 1A was given to the patient. On 27th of February, patient had a complication, had respiratory distress secondary to a peri mucus impaction, had cardiac arrest during intubation, underwent CPR and was revived. Current status, there is approximately 40% reduction in the neck mass size. He was extubated on 16th of March and he has already received his second cycle 1B. So I will be discussing under the following headings. SVC syndrome was first described in 1757 by William Hunter. It is described as the mass tumor compressing the superior vena cava, leading to distension of the upper chest wall and limb veins, leading to edema of the face, neck, and upper chest. The common causes of superior vena cava syndrome in adolescent and young adults. In malignant, it is lymphomas, approximately 50%, most common being non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and lymphoblastic lymphoma, others being neuroblastoma, germ cell tumor, thymomas, and in non-malignant causes, infections and thrombosis are most common. Clinical features of SVC syndrome, as we saw in a patient, are facial edema, arm edema, distended neck veins, distended chest veins, facial plethora, dyspnea, stridor. There is a grading of SVC syndrome. It is graded from 0 to 5. In grade 0, there is only radiographic superior vena cava obstruction in the absence of other symptoms. It is present in 10% of patients. In grade 1, there is edema in head and neck with cyanosis and plethora. In grade 2, which is present in 50% of the patients, which is the in which there is edema in head and neck with functional impairment. And grade 3 is severe, which has mild to moderate cerebral edema and mild to moderate laryngeal edema. Our patient had was in the life-threatening category and had significant laryngeal edema with stridor. Management of SVC syndrome, if the patient is in grade 0 or 1, we can go ahead and establish the histological diagnosis. And if the patient has laryngeal edema and cerebral edema, first we have to stabilize the patient, oxygenate, head and elevate, and lower limb venous access should always be considered. TLS prophylaxis should be started. Dexamethasone for laryngeal edema and cerebral edema should be started. And concurrently, we should try to establish a histological diagnosis. On review of literature on patients who had SVC syndrome and had Hodgkin lymphoma, in the last 30 years of review of literature, there were approximately 11 patients who had Hodgkin's lymphoma who had presented with an SVC syndrome diagnosis, making it a very rare presentation. Challenges in diagnosis of Hodgkin lymphoma. We all know that FNAC does not establish a definitive diagnosis. This case highlights that the patient had already had two FNACs and two biopsies from outside. That it is the importance of an adequate biopsy interpreted by an experienced pathologist, which leads to a timely diagnosis. There are many unusual presentations of Hodgkin lymphoma. Hodgkin lymphoma can mimic many disorders. It involves many systems and have varied presentation. So in cutaneous, there can be erythema nodosum, lichenoid changes, neurologic cerebral degeneration, minimal change disease, hemophagocytosis, coagulopathies, hypercalcemia. So for an early diagnosis, we should have a high index of clinical suspicion. The treatment of advanced stage classic Hodgkin lymphoma, the treatment options being ABVD, BACOG, and BVAVD. ABVD was given to a patient. It is a preferred regimen. It is a daycare therapy. Several RCTs have shown that failed to show survival benefit with other intense regimens like BACOG and BVAVD. It is cheaper, costing around 3,000 rupees per cycle. As compared to the newer therapies, in which brentuximab, vedotin cost is around 2.5 lakhs per cycle. The current state of the patient is there is around 40% reduction in the size of the neck mass. There is dressing over the ulcer sites. The plan is to restage with PET-CT after cycle 2B. The take-home message is that SVC syndrome is a hematological emergency. Early stabilization and treatment is the goal. Early histopathological diagnosis should be pursued with proper precautions, and discussion with the pathologist is of utmost importance. Lymphoma is the most common cause of SVC syndrome in adolescent and young adults, and Hodgkin lymphoma with superior vena cava syndrome is a rare presentation.
In conclusion, all's well then ends well means with the final diagnosis from our pathology teams. We were able to start his chemotherapy timely and able to salvage this boy. Now he's in a good shape. Thanks to all. Any questions, please?
Thanks for the question. The post started 2 years back with a small tiny T-cell lymphoma. Okay, now the so of course, more than 2 years. It's something that it can be possible for 2 years.
It's very unlikely. But as we have in between biopsy also, that doesn't show anything. So we cannot say it was a malignant. But it was a suspicion. Hodgkin is a number of what we call RS cells or mononuclear cells are very minimal, so we can be missed. Can happen in Hodgkin. That was mostly for some sort of reduction. Otherwise, there was no indication for starting chemotherapy in this case.
Just a small query. You had mentioned that the biopsy to be done in epinesis suspicious. So what exactly do you mean by suspicious epinesy from the pathologist and you? And what if epinesy does not show evidence of lymphoma? Because it's the report that we are seeing.
Epinesy cannot
he's doing well now.
Yes,
out of his, what the prognosis for him eventually?
Sir, in this case, as per Hasselklever index 6, his 5-year survival probability is 42%. It all depends on his response to chemotherapy. If we able to achieve complete remission within 2 cycles of ABVD, then we can shorten his chemotherapy duration and give radiotherapy to involved field radiation.
Why you
So
by the time he came to us, it was pretty obvious.
Yes.
So they told us which medicine. But your question about why the diagnosis was missed, I think the pandemic has also contributed to the delay.
Probably, yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.